So our second gospel reading is taken from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 through 45, and I will be reading it only in English. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came forward to him and said to Jesus, "Teacher, we want you to do whatever we ask for us, whatever we ask of you." And he said to them, "What is it that you want me to do for you?" And they said to him, "Grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory." But Jesus said to them, "You do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" They replied, "We are able." Then Jesus said to them, "The cup that I drink, you will drink, and with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared." When the ten heard this, they began to be angry with James and John. Jesus called them and said to them, "You know that among the Gentiles, those whom they recognize as the rulers lord it over them, and the great ones are tyrants over them. But it is not so among you. But whoever wishes to be great among you must be your servant, and whoever wishes to be first among you must be slave to all of all. The Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as ransom for many." This is the word of the Lord. One of the things that fascinates me the most about scripture passages like this one is the backstory behind it. The backstory, as you may know, is just the history or background information about a character. It gives you a clue as to why the character is doing what he is doing. It helps you understand his motivation. So when I read a passage like this one, where James and John ask to sit next to Jesus for all eternity, my mind immediately goes to this. Why? What could possibly be their motivation in making such a strange request? Did James and John think they were superior to the other disciples, I wonder? If so, why? Did they feel they deserved such an honor? If so, what had they done to merit this? Maybe James and John just wanted to feel special. But here again, why? Did they, for example, have low self-esteem for which they needed a fix? Delusions of grandeur that needed to be fed? Narcissistic tendencies that made them feel as if they were the centers of their own universe? What could possibly be their motivation for making such a strange request? What's the backstory here? It can be difficult to construct a backstory without a lot of details, and the Gospel of Mark, as you know from reading through it, is notoriously skimpy on details. Mark tends to hit the highlights in his Gospel, so what we generally get in Mark is sort of a stripped-down essence of a story without a lot of detail. So it can be tough to construct a backstory in Mark, but not impossible. Clues can be found, for instance, by looking at how Mark pieces things together, which is one of the things this narrative lectionary is really good at doing. For example, what comes before each passage? What comes after? What's the thread that's tying the particular story we're going together? For example, in this situation, the story of James and John asking for special treatment, I found it very interesting to read what Daniel just read for us a few moments ago. What comes right before their request is this. Jesus telling his disciples what his future is going to bring. And it's not going to be very pretty. Because Jesus' future, according to Jesus himself, involves Jesus being arrested, flogged, and killed. Imagine, just for a moment, how that must have sounded to James and John. Jesus, their beloved teacher and friend, would soon be gone. Just gone. As in, not here anymore. Not there to advise them, not there to teach them, not there to comfort them, just not there at all. I would imagine that was a very scary thing for them to think about. Scary enough maybe for them to want to do something about it. Scary enough maybe for them to ask to sit next to Jesus for all eternity. Scary enough for them to connect with Jesus in some way, however they could. We can relate to James and John, can't we? Because isn't Southminster facing that same sort of situation with Steve retiring next week? After all, Steve will soon be gone, just like Jesus will soon be gone. Thankfully, Steve does not have arrest, assault, and crucifixion in his future. As with Jesus, but still, you know, when Steve retires, he'll be gone. Which is a really scary thought to think about, isn't it? It's scary to think about what Southminster will be like without Steve. 35 years after all, is a very long time. Many of us, myself included, have no recollection of the Southminster that exists without Steve. Steve was here when we moved to Chicago in the early 90s. He was there when we left 7 years later. He has been here throughout the ups and downs and ins and outs of my life, of your life, of all of our lives these past many years. A constant and steady presence we could always count on. Steve has helped us connect with God in so many ways, through his preaching, through his teaching, through his prayers, and through his friendship. He's helped us grow our faith in so many ways. He's walked with us on our spiritual journeys, both individually and collectively as a congregation. So it's scary to think about him, maybe. And it's sad, because why don't you? And it's bittersweet, because even though we're scared and sad and apprehensive about the future, we're also, at the exact same time, just so happy for Steve and his family. We're happy that new vistas are opening up for him and Susie. We're happy that we get to enjoy retirement. And we're happy and grateful for the 35 years that he's devoted to Christ here at Southminster. But still, it is so hard to see the end. It feels in many ways like the end of an era, which, of course, is maybe how it felt to James and John when they heard what Jesus said about his future. The end of an era. Which is maybe why they asked Jesus for their special seats in heaven. But Jesus, of course, declined their request. Those seats next to him, he said, were already spoken for to the ones for whom they had been prepared. And then Jesus turned his attention to the other 10 disciples, who by now had caught wind of what the first two had asked, and were not pleased about this, to say the least. And Jesus spoke. "Stop fighting," Jesus said to them. "Stop arguing about who's best and who's first, and focus instead on serving one another. For it is in serving one another that your greatness will be found." What's Jesus' motivation here, do you think? What's the backstory, do you suppose, behind Jesus' advice to his disciples? I think Jesus' motivation is reassurance. Reassurance born of his love for them. "Don't be afraid," he seems to be saying. "And don't waste time on things that don't matter, like seats in heaven or arguing about silly things. Focus instead on what does matter. Focus instead on your mission. Focus on serving one another and on doing it well. Model yourselves after Jesus Christ. Model yourselves after me, and you'll be fine," he said. This is good advice for all of us, don't you think? Change happens. It is part of life. I love that quote about change being inevitable, but progress being optional. Let's choose progress. Progress, after all, is the legacy that Steve gives us. That ability that he has taught us to invent and reinvent ourselves again and again and again, while staying true to our mission and to who we are. Let's keep that as our connection with Steve. And let's focus on Jesus' advice to us. Serve one another, do it well, be like Christ. Amen.